Today's reading is from 1 John 4:16, Proverbs 22:15, and Romans 5:16 through 17. God is love, and all who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. Foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child. The rod of discipline, correction administered with godly wisdom and loving kindness, will remove it far from him. So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives, and then you won't be doing what your sinful natures crave. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desire that are the opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other, so you are not free to carry on your good intentions. These are the words of our Lord.
We're so glad you're here. God has some great things in store for us. I want to talk to you about how love is discipline. And as I was thinking through this from my own generation, I'm from the generation where discipline was common and physical. And my generation, discipline was a favorite pastime in my generation. Not only could you get spanked at home, but they enjoyed doing it at school. The neighbors sometimes liked to join in. It was just a lot of fun. Beating the kids was a favorite pastime growing up. I'm joking, you know, but discipline was a heavy emphasis, and maybe to an extent where affirmation and love was not as prominent as it probably should have been. So when I was growing up, the emphasis was definitely on discipline. You could get in trouble and get physically punished at school. Teachers were empowered to help you learn, whatever that meant. I can remember in seventh grade, we had he was kind of a friend of mine, but he was towards the back. He was really clowning and acting up and everything in our math class. And we were upstairs he was making just chaos. And the teacher had dealt with him several times and he just kept going. So I saw the teacher just kind of abruptly walk to the back as a man teacher, walk to the back, just kind of grab him by the arm and open the door and then close the door behind him. And the staircase was just after that. And we just heard plump, 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 plump. So he was, we found out later he was thrown down the stairs. He survived. It was just a different generation. It was a different time. And if you failed, in school, your parents didn't visit the teacher, they visited you. And they talked about you and how you were failing, and then they might eventually get around to the teacher to apologize and to say, I'm so sorry, my son or my daughter is not learning and not doing what they're supposed to be doing. It was a different time. Trophies were for winners. Only winners got trophies. It was during that time growing up, and if you wanted something that you didn't have, you got a job and earned the money to have it because your parents just didn't go out and buy it for you. I bought my first bike, a 10-speed bike. It was orange. It was really cool. And then I remember I had a little extra money, and I saved up, and I put a little mirror, a kind of a rearview mirror that would be on that 10-speed bike, you know, and I'm riding down the road adjusting that mirror and not paying attention, and there is a truck parked. The guy had gotten out to go to what we don't have anymore too, is a phone booth, and he was on the phone, and he's watching me not paying any attention, adjusting my mirror, and boom, I run into the back of his truck and land in the back of his truck. I mean, my bike flipped up, and I landed in the back of his truck, you know. So this was the age and the era of when I grew up and how people looked at things. When you came home crying, Mom wanted to know what you did to deserve it. What happened? We used to, you know, we would get around. Now we commiserate, our generation does, with each other to talk about who got the worst beatings. You know, it's like a badge of honor. You know, like, you know, oh my, you know, my parents, they you know, they woke up and, you know, got us out, and we had to start working at 7 o'clock in the morning, and we didn't get to go to bed until like 8 or 9 o'clock at night. We worked all day long in the yard, and just they had us move rocks from one side of the yard to the other side of the yard, and it was just a horrible experience. So my generation will do that. We'll just start talking about, oh, and, you know, we'll tell that story. It was all eight hours a day my parents worked this. And then when we finished telling our story, the other guy will go, oh, your parents must have loved you. They got us up so early. We worked 12 hours a day, and we had to walk uphill both ways and bare feet in the snow to go to school and come home. And the stories just go on and on. So it wasn't quite that bad, but it definitely was an age of discipline. And they were convinced that that was the best way to show love. And, you know, they were concerned that without proper discipline, we might stray and we might get off track and be hurt and be wounded. And there really was some sincere love in a lot of the discipline from my generation. But maybe one of the things that was left out in some cases was affirmation and love. I have to say, in my home, I got a little bit of both, got the affirmation, the love, the encouragement, and I also got the strong discipline. But we today are living in an age of excess, aren't we? So the question comes, if we are to set limits, if that is love and if that is what God wants, how do we go about setting those limits? All children and adults need love, but they also need limits, they need affirmation, but they also need discipline. Author and Christian psychologist Dan Allender said this. He said, every child grows up asking two core questions, and here they are. The first one is, am I loved? The second one is, can I get my own way? Can I always get my own way? And so part of what I want to do with you this morning is eliminate any doubt in your mind about these two core questions that I think they don't really necessarily even go away as we become young adults and adults. We still struggle with this. Am I loved? And can I always get my own way? It's a lifelong struggle for us. So I want to put an end to it. I want to help you. And after I answer this, if you have other things you need to do, you can just go. And God bless you today, because this is the essence of what we're going to be talking about, right? But if you want some more proof, hang out, stick around, and we'll talk about that. The first one is, am I loved? Yes, you are loved. We talked about it last week. Often our problem is not that we don't love God, but we don't know how much God loves us. We have not truly been convinced about how much God loves and cares for us. You are deeply loved. And the wonderful thing we talked about last week is that it's a constant with God. He made that choice and that decision. And it's not about feelings and emotions. It's about a choice that He made. He is love, and He loves you. And so God has, made that decision a long time ago. And no matter what pathway you've gone down, no matter what you have done, He's never going to love you more. He's never going to love you less. He loves you. The second thing is, can I always get my way? The answer to that is no. You cannot do anything that you want to do. There are limits. There are boundaries. God has set them, and we need to live by them. So deep down, we all know that a child needs to know that they are loved, and that they are joyously loved and completely accepted. But we also know they need those limits and those boundaries. I worked for a time with a pastor in Phoenix. A short time, we went away from our home church to do a 6-month work with them on helping them with their children's program and their youth program. And I loved this guy. I knew him my whole life, had deep respect for him, a great man of integrity. They had built a really awesome church there in Tempe, Arizona. And so we were digging in and working. And in the course of our time there, one day he and I needed to go on a long journey across town, picking up supplies and getting prepared for one of the kids' crusades that we were going to be doing there. And so in the course of that, he starts talking to me, and he opens up and he shares with me. He says, Alan, I grew up in a home where all of our needs were taken care of. My parents gave us always enough food to eat, clean clothes to wear. Our parents took care of all of our basic needs. But he said, in all of my life growing up in that home, I never remember my parents saying to me, I love you. I never remember in all the time that I grew up in that home, my parents embracing me in a hug, putting a kiss on my cheek, telling me that they loved me in a significant way. You know, hearing that from him, it really kind of closed the circle on, how I knew him and had grown to to know him as being a person that was more analytical than physical in nature. And he's one of those guys that he's not just running around hugging everybody, but he will hug you. He's learned that, you know, but it's not natural. You ever hug those people that it's not really natural with them? They're just like, what do I do with my hands? I don't know what to do. And he just came from that environment, you know, where he didn't really have, examples for him. And so it kind of closed the circle for me. But when he shared that story, it helped me to realize there are so many people who have not had the same experience that maybe I had, maybe you had growing up, and maybe there are some of you that are here today who that story is similar to your upbringing and your experience. We all need love as along with discipline. But we need discipline in our lives. And the reason that we do scripturally is what theologians call the depravity of man, the depravity of man. And the Bible tells us about it. One of the passages that we read earlier for our opening scripture is found in Proverbs 22:15. I like the Amplified version there. It kind of balances out what's being said here. For us, foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child. The rod of discipline or correction administered with godly wisdom and kindness will remove it far from him. We need boundaries and we need correction because we have fallen away. How many of you believe in this thing called the depravity of man? All right, I'm going to convince the rest of you, all right? As a child, many of you know that Michelle and I were children and youth pastors earlier in our ministry. And so we were constantly seeing parents coming to us talking about this depravity thing. They wanted to know, you know, who had taught their children to lie, who had taught their children to steal, who had taught their children to be selfish, who had taught them to be violent and, with one another, to be abusive. And it seemed like as they're talking to us, explaining these things, we really need you to help us with our children. You know, can you guys come and meet with them? Can you go out to I remember having, you have all these wise ideas when you're, a youth pastor. Derek probably remembers some of these experiences, but these two girls, they had shoplifted and they're sisters. And so the parents wanted me to meet with them, and talk to them. And just, their parents, these were good people, a good family. And like, they didn't take their children to the store and say, hey, here's how to get some free stuff, carry an extra big bag or something, They'd never done that. And so they were just astonished. Their girls went to a store and just shoplifted and they were in some serious trouble. So I'm trying to, I'm a young youth pastor. I'm setting I'm going to teach these girls, And so I took a pair of handcuffs, And I said, I started talking to them about, how serious this is. And, I said, one day they'll come and they'll slap the handcuff. I put one of those handcuffs on this hand. And I said, they don't put your hands in front of you. They put your hands behind you. And I put the other one on and suddenly realized that I'm not going to be able to get these things off. Fortunately, we are good ways through our talk, And I didn't need to take them home. Their dad was over at the picnic table. And so I said, okay, we're finished. You guys have any questions? No. I said, all right, go over and meet your dad. And and I'm off to try to figure out if I can get a hold of somebody that can help me get out of handcuffs. Proverbs 51:5 says, for I was born a sinner. Yes, from the moment my mother conceived me. That is the condition we are born into this world in. And that is our fallback nature is sin. When Micah was about 5 years old, our oldest daughter, we had bought her one Christmas, a little Tyco kitchen set. It had a little sink and it has a cabinet up here. It's all plastic and had some, a refrigerator at the bottom. And, it had some utensils and things, plates and different kinds of things like that you could use with it. And she just really loved it. And we had it set up in her room. Now, my brother would come over and he had all boys and his oldest was about the same age as Micah. And as soon as they would drive up, we'd invite her over for dinner or something. As soon as they would drive up, this happened numerous times. their oldest son would jump out of the car almost before they had stopped, and he would run up to our door, ding, 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 ring the doorbell, you know, a million times. And so we go and we open the door, boom, he's past us. He runs past us. He goes down the hall. He runs into her bedroom and he takes that that kitchen set and pushes it over and scatters everything all over the place. And so this happened three or four times, you know, and each time we're like, you know, why did you do it? And what do you think we heard from him? How many of you know this answer?
I don't know.
I don't know. Depravity. Depravity. And so one day, Michelle, in her fallback depravity nature, decided she was going to hide behind the door of the bedroom. Same thing happened. Ding, 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 ding. I open the door. Boom, he comes running in. He's running down the hall. He runs over to that to get ready to push it over. She jumps out from behind the door and goes, "What are you doing?" And he's like, "Oh," he's scared. And she goes, "You touch that and I'm going to beat you." And the shock and the awe scared him from that moment of doing it. But we see it all the time, don't we? We see people do things. You ask them, "Why did you do this?" I don't know. You know, it's just there is no answer. It's depravity. We're born into it, and without discipline, without correction, we gravitate back towards it. We're told in Romans chapter 5, verse 16 and 17, one of the verses we read earlier. So I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives, and then you won't be what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what sinful nature desires. These two factors are consistently fighting against each other, so you are not free to carry out the good intentions. So what is needed is correction administered with godly wisdom and kindness. Why is the generation that we're in now really struggling with discipline, maybe more so than the generation that parented me? Why is it such a struggle? Recent exhaustive research has uncovered a couple of things that I want to talk to you about this morning that are behind why there is a struggle with discipline, and we're kind of going down the pathway of helping parents at this point in the message. So parents, pull your notes out and get ready. These are the two things that have been discovered that are problematic for this generation in administering discipline. And the first one is exhaustion. And the second one is emotional neediness on the part of the parents. An exhaustive study, research, and they're uncovering that exhaustion, parents are just worn down mentally, emotionally, physically. Second, their emotionally neediness in the lives of parents. Lawrence Steinberg, a psychologist at Temple University and the author of the 10 Basic Principles of Good Parenting, he wrote this, and I thought it was just so profound. I want to share it with you this morning. Today's parents put in more hours on the job, and at the end of the long work week, it's tempting to buy peace with yes rather than mar precious family time with a conflict. A lot of parents are answering the call of God on their life to vocations. I am certainly not one that says that, you know, mom should always stay home, or, you know, you should do what God is directing you to. And in many cases, that's how God is leading and that's how God is providing. And moms can do that, and I'm grateful for that. But there are moms who are answering a call on their life to a vocation that God has prepared them for, a career, and they have work that they do there that is not only the work of secular society, but it is a work of ministry in secular society. How does a police officer come to know about Jesus? Well, women and men police officers who know Jesus are working there, and they're introducing, they're being the light and the example. And so I want to recognize that call. I want to honor that. And I am for what God is calling you to do. And I want to, and I believe we do as a church, honor those who want to stay home and homeschool kids and parent that way. And those who feel that they're to be the salt and the light, and God's called them, they've given them a specific set of gifts, and they need to be engaged in those gifts. But that has brought about change in this generation, so much so that there is a great deal of exhaustion from the requirements of these career callings. And they know that many of these parents, they know when they come home, they need to have these tough conversations. They need to make sure that homework is done and completed. They need to emphasize the family values. They need to deal with rule breaking, but it's so much easier to order a pizza and sit down in front of the TV. Now, I want you to look up here for a moment because I do understand and I'm living out that we're talking about right now. I have been exhausted. We had three kids and I come home and realize there needs to be some crucial conversations. There needs to be some correction here. Dust needs to be flying for a few minutes and we need to get everybody back on the same page. And I'm exhausted. I don't know if I can muster the strength up to have that conversation. And yet, you know, God will strengthen us and God will help us to be able to do that. And we have had to get together, come together. The first thing is for mom and dad to be on the same page, right? So Michelle and I usually have the first conversation. Are we on the same page about how we need to deal with this? Okay, because I could just fly into upset right now. And I might not be going down the right path. Are we on the same page? And it's good. We talk about it and then let's do it together. We're both exhausted, we're both tired, but let's take this and do what God has called us to do because this is important to our family. Values of our family have been violated and we have got to correct this or our family is going to be leading or going in a different direction than God wants them to go. So parents, you are to lead your family to love God. You are to do you're to do that and you can do that and have a career. If God's called you to do that, you have to make that commitment to the tough work that is there and is involved in that. Throughout our lives, Michelle and I have been able to do that with God's help, strengthening us. But with respect to this first point of exhaustion, let me just state the obvious to all of us. It enforcing limits requires energy. Enforcing boundaries and limits requires energy. You have to have the energy. I have not corrected my family by just saying, you know, I'm so tired. Why don't you guys just leave me alone and do what's right? You know, I'm just tired of this. Stop fighting. But when I rise up and use the energy God has given me and say, this is not happening. You're going to your room. And I'm going to meet each of you there, and we're going to have some conversations. And we're going to talk about what the family values are. We're going to talk about what God wants us to do and be. And we are going to change from this point forward. The setting and enforcing of limits requires energy. Sitting down with your child to read the Bible, it requires energy. Right? Hello? They don't just automatically pull the Bible off the library shelf and start reading. I don't know if you noticed that or not, but weird how that doesn't happen. Calling the family to prayer for issues in the home and the community, it requires energy. We do that as a family. When we come up, there are issues that we're all facing, could be physical illnesses, could be financial, those kind of things. We call the family together and say, it's time to pray. Dad, I've got homework. I've got, you know, I got to do this. I got to do that. Why are we always praying? Because it works. Get over here. Let's do it. And we'll pray about your homework situation too. Getting the family together to attend church, is difficult and it requires energy. My wife got up, you know, I had to leave and go to the church early when our kids were little. And she had to do all of their hair. And this is back when we actually, you know, really decked out. We always looked like Easter Sunday. You know, back every Sunday was Easter Sunday when I was growing, you know, when we were that young as pastors. And so she's got the kids in these Bryant dresses, you know, the girls. And Zach didn't look very good in a Bryant dress, but the rest. And had them, you know, their hair done and they looked fine and stuff like that. And she came along, you know, she put all that effort and work into. So we had to get up early for that to happen. We had to get everybody fed. We had to get, you know, but we understood the value and the importance of disciplining our kids and letting them know how important it is to be in God's house. If we can't hope that the next generation is going to be more faithful than we are, we have to set the example and show them the importance of it. And I know some of you are single parents, and I honor you so much for the effort that you're putting into coming. We don't always appreciate that. We don't always understand what's behind the scenes. It is a lot of work, and it requires a lot of energy just to get here. And, you know, have our kids here for church. And we honor you for that. We're so thankful that you're making that kind of an effort to set boundaries and discipline. I'm going to ask you this. How are you managing your energy? Who's getting the best of your week? Is the workplace and the career field getting the best of your week? Are your friends that you like to hang out, that you get energized from and have fun with, are they getting the best of your life? Or is your family getting the best of you? All the best of your energy, the best of your time. What do you need to say no to so that you can say yes to helping set limits in your own family? Energy is necessary to do discipline well. It takes time to teach correct behavior to, you know, it's not just going to be one conversation. We're going to have to take time. King David had a son, Adonijah, who was corrupting the kingdom, and he was doing things that, you know, were going to be so destructive for his life and many others around him. And it's the author of 1 Kings makes this editorial comment, which you might just slip by and not really read. In 1 Kings chapter 1, verse 6, he says this. He says, David had never interfered with his son or asked him why he was behaving the way that he was. What an indictment on David as a parent. What an indictment. We used to do parenting classes, and Michelle and I used to encourage parents, this is your home. You better know what's in your child's bedroom. What's under their bed, what's under their mattress, what's in their, you know, we would have these just like jail checks, you know, we would have those periodically with our kids. It's our home. It's our set of values there. We want you to live godly and to be safe. And while you're here, we're going to enforce that. We're going to make sure that that's the case. Emotional, neediness aside, we care most about your soul and your heart, and we want you to be the best that God has in store for you. So energize. The second one is emotional neediness in parenting. Deep in the heart of every parent is this fear that at some point, as you set boundaries and limits and stuff like that, that this lovely child that you have poured yourself into looks a lot like you and hangs out in the house is going to turn their back on you and walk away and say these three words that no parent ever wants to hear. You can probably say it before I do. I hate you. Right? It's a great fear of every parent that that's going to be what happens for them. That they're going to get to a place where their kids are not going to like them and they have this horrible fear that their kids are going to turn on them. And I'm going to tell you that it won't happen if you're dispensing this appropriately. Love affirmation with discipline and limits. Derek, if you prepare to come back, we all need limits in our lives. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 11, no discipline is enjoyable while it is happening. It's painful. But afterwards, there is a peaceful harvest of right living with those who have who are trained in this way. Some of the most memorable moments in parenting for me personally are after we've had to have these hard conversations and the home has been stirred up because values have been violated and things have happened and And I have to rise up as a parent, and not you know, together Michelle and I talking about it, but also just as a father in the household, and to take the stand and say these things, and kids go away wounded and hurt and upset, you know, sometimes you hear a door slam. In our house, that didn't happen more than once, but you know, it would shut a little harder than normal, and you'd hear the tears and things like that, and then you start thinking, you know, I'm sitting there by myself now somewhere in the house. Sometimes it would be in my office, and I would just be sitting there thinking, you know, I wonder if I was too hard. I wonder if my kids are going to love me. You know, this was tough. Dust is still settling, you know, from the confrontation. It's quiet. And at best, you hear a little sniffling or whatever, you know. And this would happen more times than not. One of the kids would slip around the corner somewhere, come up to me, put their arms around my neck and say, "Dad, I love you. I'm sorry." And then before too long, another one would come around the corner and they'd slip into the office and sit in my lap and put their arms around me and say, "Daddy, I love you." What is that all about? It's because true discipline and setting of boundaries is love. It's love. If you let them do whatever they want to do, they start feeling like nobody really cares. If I hurt myself, if I violate rules and values, nobody cares. But when you set those appropriate boundaries and those limits, there's a place that cares for me. There's a place where I'm loved. There's a place where everything is not okay. I can't do just anything I want to do. And it feels right. It just feels good. 1 John 4:16 says, "God is love, and all who live in love live in God, and God lives in them." That love involves discipline. Some of you as adults may be receiving some correction, some discipline from God in an area of your life. He's imposed limits and you're kind of upset about it. And you want what somebody else has, or you don't understand why that it seems so unfair that God is not opening this door or that door or something else. And you just feel like God right now has put some fences up. There's a beautiful passage about a vineyard in Isaiah. And, you know, when you read through it, you know, because it starts out talking about my beloved vineyard. And you're thinking, oh, beautiful place. We all think about a vineyard. But when he starts describing this vineyard, the first thing he does is put fences up on this. Because then he starts pitching out all the rocks. This is just a rocky piece of ground when you start reading it, you know. It's nothing. There's no vineyard there. It's what God saw the potential. It could be, but he starts by putting the fences around it and he pitches the rocks out because everything is going to want to run when God starts dealing with the issues of our heart. Our nature is, let's run. And God says, there's a fence there. Whoops. Let's run. There's a fence there. And God constrains us in to a certain point to say, I love you. I care about you. And it's a beautiful passage of God showing that he loves and he cares about us. So for some of you as adults, you might be experiencing this right now. Some of you as parents struggling to set the boundaries in your home. And your fear is they're going to say, I hate you. They're going to turn their back on me. They're going to run away. They're going to not love me anymore. And God's saying, rise up. I called you to be the parent. I called you to be the authority in that household. I called you to say what needs to be said. I called you to have the tough conversations. I called you to set the limits. They're not going to get it anywhere else. You're the parents I chose. You're the ones that I decided would best love them through discipline. If you're in either of those categories, we're inviting our worship, our prayer team to come forward and to agree in prayer with you. Derek's in a moment is going to lead us back through worship chorus. And but if God is working on you in that area of discipline and correction personally, respond. Invite somebody to pray with you. Help me to be patient. I've gone through seasons in my life where God was dealing with some discipline in my life. And it's not comfortable. I'll tell you, it really isn't. But in the end, I surrendered and discovered that it was the best thing for my life. And I know you will too. And some of you as parents that just need the courage, just need somebody to agree with you. God is going to help you. We're not perfect. Michelle and I were not perfect parents. We made mistakes. We did say, I'm sorry to our kids a number of times. Even in recent times, we've had to go back and say, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have gotten involved in that. You know, I was out of line. But since we have that kind of relationship, they understand that we love them and that discipline is about what's in their best interest. So would you stand with me as we worship and our prayer team comes? And if you need prayer and want prayer this morning, I want to invite you to come and let God meet you here and encourage you.